It's a beautiful day.
Oh yeah. Welcome to Horse Country USA. I'm Julie Mohan.
I'm Chad Eubanks. Today we're in Nashville, Tennessee, at the home of singer-songwriter Templeton Thompson.
And Chad rides with Hall of Fame trainer Clint Haverty.
So sit back, relax, and take a ride with us through Horse Country USA.
I think there should be a lot more songs about horses, and that's on the radio, and yeah, they're not. Because as we know, there's tons of that music out there. There's tons of love of horses music out there. When I'm writing horsey songs, some of them are what I call, they will be right on the nose. You know, like you'll know exactly what I'm writing about. But at the same time, some of it will just almost be kind of a reference to, could mean something else. Even like in our current single, When I Get That Pony Rode, you know, it's obviously When I Get That Pony Rode, but the really neat thing is you don't have to look at it literally. You can look at that metaphorically and go, you know, whatever it is that you're trying to accomplish in life. That's been a big thing that folks have really responded to that song.
Face down in the dirt, every inch of me hurts. Guessing wasn't such a perfect landing. Yeah, I'm still alive, not sure how I survived. It was a hell of a ride till it ended. I guess that's what you get when you leave. You don't know.
I'm just grateful. I think more people have paid attention to me as an artist because of having a video of that caliber. So I'm grateful. You know, it's a hell of a ride. I mean, it's what the song says. It is. It's hard. There are days where I'm like, what am I doing? I have no idea, you know, and I want this. And I'm not there yet, but I'm getting closer, you know, and it's like, or I have lots of goals. I'll always be reaching, so I'm always going to be working to get that pony rode. I don't know if there's going to be an official, like, well, I did that. You know, I'm always going to be. I heard Reba talk about that a little bit one time, you know, that you always need to be striving.
Templeton talks about the song she wrote that was recorded by Reba McIntyre.
We cut the demo, mm-hmm. and I sang the lead on the demo, and then a wonderful man and talented man by the name of John Cowan sang backgrounds, and a wonderfully, incredibly talented woman named Laura Vita sang background. And so we find out, song's been pitched to Reba's camp, and it's on hold. So it's on hold. That's awesome. That's a huge compliment when you get a song on hold. Doesn't mean a dang thing in the business. It just means, well, that's nice. It may get played for the artist, may not, may be on hold for a year. You know, sometimes songs, and then you don't have the opportunity to pitch it to another artist because it maybe got put on hold for 2 years. I don't know. But hey, Reba, hold it for 10 years. I don't care. Just please record it. So anyway, went on hold, and it all happened really fast. And then next thing I hear, she's going to cut it. I'm like, oh my God. Next thing I hear, she's cut it. And this is when we lived in East Nashville, and I remember sitting on the sofa with Sam and going, next thing's going to happen. I'm just putting out in the universe. She's going to call, and she's going to want me to sing background vocals on the record with her. Yeah, you know, just being totally silly. Well, the label called like the next day, I'm not kidding, and wanted who sang lead on the demo and who sang backgrounds to come in and sing backgrounds on her recording of it. I'm like, what? So this all really did happen within a week or so, and it was supposed to be a single, but I'm not the only singer-songwriter in Nashville to have the story that says, yeah, it was going to be the next single. That happens all the time. Happens all the time, and it's okay. You know, I'm grateful. I've got the platinum album on the wall that shows that happened, you know. Deep down inside me, I know I really have something to show when I get that pony roll. When I get that pony roll,
we go to a horse show or a rodeo or whatever it is that you're going to, it would be pretty heartbreaking to be stuck on the side of the road tying your horses to the trailer in, say, downtown Dallas.
You know, flats never happen in a good place. We've alleviated that with Assault One by treating the tire as preeminent to a blowout or a flat. There's 17 different fibers, and at the moment of a puncture, all those fibers come together and immediately and permanently seal the tire from loss of air pressure.
Why the music business? I have been singing my whole life since I was, I think, old enough to know what singing was. But the thing is, I never thought about it professionally until I actually went to college. I went to college at the University of Virginia in Charlottesville.
While going to college, an article about Trisha Yearwood caught her attention.
She had done an internship at a record label in Nashville, and, you know, at the time, my God, she was one of the hottest stars, and in my opinion, still is and always will be. And I thought, well, dang, maybe if I move to Nashville, I've always wanted to do music, maybe I can get my foot in the door, you know, maybe being an intern. And that's what happened. And these guys one day walked in. They just walked in, and they had a little briefcase that said, like, Nashville or bust, and they were asking if I would listen to their songs. And I'm like, I'm just the intern. Seriously, you don't want to play me your songs. I'm like, please. And I'm like, oh, okay. So I sat behind the desk listening to these guys sing their hearts and souls out and realized that I was sitting in the wrong chair. Yeah, my partner in crime is my wonderful husband, Sam Gay. I call him my rock star renaissance cowboy. He is, oh man, he's so dang talented. He just blows my mind.
She tells us how her husband, Sam, proposed to her in France during a singer-songwriter tour.
One morning, we were getting ready in the Manoir de Saint on this beautiful horse farm where they have trotting horses. And the host for us is named Philippe. And he had promised us a ride that morning in the sulky around the track. And, you know, horse crazy, right? My focus is on horses. And so I was getting ready in the bathroom, like washing my face, brushing my teeth, that kind of stuff. And Sam walks in the bathroom and he goes, I have a question for you. That was so cute. That's how you propose. I'm like, yeah. And asked me to marry him. It was awesome. And what's so funny is, you know, of course I'm like, yes. I'm like, oh my God, freaking out, you know. And then you hear Philippe, because we were like on the second floor of this Manoir, and he's downstairs. He's got this beautiful horse hooked up to the sulky, and he's saying, Templeton, do you want to go for a ride in the sulky? You know, and I'm like, yes. So I'm like, yes, and yes. And I go running downstairs, and Sam's like, oh, fine. I see how you are. I see how it's going to kind of be the rest of our lives. And he totally gets it. He knows how just horse crazy I am. but we have a brand new song called Believe in Me that Sammy and I wrote with our new dear rock star cowgirl sister, Miss Mary Miller Jordan of Mustang Million fame. And she sent me this beautiful poem. She writes poetry. And Sam and I just, you know, doing what we do as songwriters, you know, kind of had some things start flowing, and so borrowed some of the lyrics from the poem, and then we came up with some stuff ourselves and found out from Mary, you know, what she really wanted to get accomplished in the song, you know, what needed to happen in there, and we wound up with a song called Believe in Me.
You know, you can always learn from somebody. Somebody's always going to help you if you'll just listen. Inside hind leg, I want them, when they're slowing down, I want them slowing down on the inside hind leg because they can stand up on it and slow down. When they turn around, they're going to turn around on their inside hind leg. And the beat deal, you count one, two, three, four, one, just like you're waltzing. And and when you're stopping, for some reason, and I can't explain why, it just puts you in perfect time with your horse. And when you're turning, when you're slowing down, the whole deal. Steve Metcalf taught Zane that up in Gladstone, New Jersey. We were up there at a raining. And Zane was having trouble changing leads on Blonde at the Bar, I think it was. And he said, Clint, do you mind if I help your son? I said, gosh, I wish you would. I'm tired of him. And he took him aside over there and taught him how to count on the lead changes. And you don't see Zane miss a lead very often.
Right.
I don't remember the last time I've seen him miss a lead.
So when you're counting every time that horse puts foot on the ground?
Don't make it so complicated. Just count. One,
just count.
Two, three, change. One, two, three, change. When you're turning around. One, two, three, stop, and turn. Okay. You don't worry about where the feet are like it. And I don't know why it works, but it does. Okay, go ahead and do that deal. Just walk him around there in a circle, about a 10 or 15 foot circle, and go ahead and two-hand
and
him
two-hand
there until
him.
You get the feel of it there. And I really like to two-hand them in this exercise. Like right now, you'll pick the left rein up, use your left leg, and then, there you go. Go ahead and just get his feet moving. Don't let him get dead-footed on you. Get his feet moving. You're side-passing a little bit too much. Now, whenever his cadence is even, you got to get the cadence even there. Get your cadence even. Move your left leg, bump with your right, left leg, bump, 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 not your spur. Just your calf. Whenever you're ready now, count and stop and turn back to your left. Use your outside rein. Release your inside. Now you're going to take your inside leg and let him out. Inside leg. There you go. Forward, 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 forward. Keep pushing that hip. Forward, 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 forward. Now when a horse is turning around, Chad, and they're pretty free and they feel pretty good and they're comfortable going around, they got a lot of cadence going around.
Mm-hmm.
Like I say, I don't just sit there and just burn a hole in the ground. I do that at the horse show when I'm showing. But when I'm turning a horse around, when they step up their cadence and they're really trying to turn and they do it, they're turning a little harder, a little cleaner, a little faster, I let them out. But theoretically, then the next time you ask them to stop and turn, they're going to get to that point a little quicker because they got to be let out of it.
Right.
And remember, whenever I let one out, I'll trot them around about a circle, roughly, and maybe a circle and a half, and just kind of leave them alone. As long as they're set in that arc, I leave them alone, because I want them thinking, oh, I got out of that circle, I'm being left alone, gosh, free time, McDonald meal time, so to speak, and everything.
Sure.
Okay, and about the third day, getting him ready to go to horse show, the third or fourth day, that little booger bear is turning hard. He is hunting it. He knows the drill now. And that's a lot better. Doing it like this is a lot better for me than just sitting there and hammering on them. I hate to hammer on a horse.
Sure.
Nobody's hammered on more horses than I have. Nobody. But by golly, this way is a lot easier, a lot crisper. Your horses turn crisp.
Right.
And you're not, the front end's a lot cleaner.
It seems that way.
And this horse is a lot like his mother and his daddy. I've got pictures of his daddy turning. His front feet are spread, gosh, 6-8 foot apart. And that outside front leg will come over and land right over there underneath my stirrup. And you want to talk about some plus 1.5 turns.
Right.
His mother and his daddy did both of them like that.
Absolutely.
And it was this drill right here that did it.
Right.
It wasn't because I healed them and punched on them, made them turn. I allowed them to hunt that turn.
Right.
I maintained the style, but I allowed them to find that spot. That makes sense?
It makes sense. I love it. I've been showed how to turn a horse around by a lot of different people.
Yeah.
That's probably the simplest I've ever had it.
Good. You got to be just like you're pouring water. That's how pretty it needs to be. Also, when you hold your spur in a horse,
mm-hmm.
their feet go dead.
Right.
Okay? And if you hold your spur in them, their belly kind of goes down into that spur. Horses go to pressure, and their belly will go down in that spur, hence the feet get deader. Then you got to bang harder every time. Now, if I'm going to spur a horse, I will spur a horse just like you're raking leaves.
Mm-hmm.
I will come and I will put my spur, make contact, and if they get away from that, boy, I just take my leg out. And because you're raking leaves, there's nothing there for them to lean against. Where if you hold with your spur, they have something to lean against and push against.
Right.
Up next.
Out of it. Needs a bridle.
Also, our tip of the week sponsored by Assault One Tire Protection.
We go to a horse show or a rodeo or whatever it is that you're going to. It would be pretty heartbreaking to be stuck on the side of the road, tying your horses to the trailer in, say, downtown Dallas.
You know, flats never happen in a good place. We've alleviated that with Assault One by treating the tire as preeminent to a blowout or a flat. There's 17 different fibers, and at the moment of a puncture, all those fibers come together and immediately and permanently seal the tire from loss of air pressure.
Training horses is all about being consistent with them. Whether you ride them daily, every other day, every 6 weeks, however, you want to do it real consistent. When you take a hold of them for each maneuver, you want to be consistent on how you go to them and take a hold of them. And I encourage people, and I always encourage myself, and I've got to stop and think sometimes myself, that, gosh, I got to slow myself down. I'm going too fast to his face. I'm going too fast to his belly or something. And 9 times out of 10, if I think like that, and if I have to think like that, then I darn sure was going to them too fast.
Right.
I didn't give them time to respond. And that's something that counting does. It gives me a chance to slow down and act that horse in a slower manner. To me, training a horse is getting this right here.
Right.
If you don't have this, if you don't have them thinking, Well, how can I help you? How can I get on the same page with you? I don't know how you can train a horse. I really don't. I mean, I've tried in years past. I've done everything. Mm-hmm. You can't do anything I haven't done. Period.
Right.
And this is the simplest, easiest way to train a horse. And I don't care if you're teaching them how to run a stop, whatever you're doing. You get the mind, or get the mind starting to think, what can I do to help? How can I get on the same page? Then you can train that horse. But you can't train a horse until you get his mind going that way, in an agreeable way.
You spend a lot of time, you've always been a horse trainer your whole life?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I've ridden horses all my life. Too dumb to do anything else.
And you spend a lot of time with other trainers?
No. You know, I was very fortunate. I worked for a man up in Illinois for 5 or 6 years, a guy by the name of Cletus Holland. And he and Hank used to flip quarters every Sunday for a $100 bill. Drinking coffee, flipping quarters. And one day, I'll never forget, colder than heck up there where Hank was in Ferguson Falls, Minnesota is where he was. And Cletus and him were flipping those quarters. And Cletus flipped it, landed in a coffee cup full of coffee. Hank, just a second, I can't tell you what it is. I'll tell you in a minute. And they chit-chatted there for 4 or 5 minutes. He got down to that quarter, and he could see if his head or tail. Whoops, I lost. Now, he could have said, I won, and got him dragged another quarter out. That taught me a lot right there. Don't ever tell a story.
That's a good lesson.
It was a great lesson for me. I sat there, and I just marveled at that little deal right there. It's pretty cool.
Right.
Turning the horse around is a matter. Are you ready? Are you getting this? Turning the horse around is a matter of opening and shutting doors. That's all we're doing. And by pulling back a little bit, we're shutting the door out of front. Mm-hmm. By pointing with our inside foot, we're opening the door up to the inside, so that horse will turn right around there. Our outside leg, because we sat on our outside pin or outside hip, shuts that outside door. So by opening up your inside leg, the inside door is open up so that horse knows to turn that way. Walk over there and try that. Always stop before you turn, Chad.
Stop before you turn. That's a good lesson for me.
Okay, stop right there. Reach up there and take the bridle off of him. Leave the reins around his neck. Now, trot him around and do the same thing. Turn to the outside.
Turn to the outside.
Be sure to sit down on your outside hip. Turn him to your right. Just turn to your right.
Turn
to
my right.
Turn. Cluck. Point, there you go, out of it, stop and set. Who needs a bridle?
Exactly.
Today's tip is brought to you by Assault One Tire Protection.
We go to a horse show or a rodeo or whatever it is that you're going to. It would be pretty heartbreaking to be stuck on the side of the road, tying your horses to the trailer in, say, downtown Dallas.
You know, flats never happen in a good place. We've alleviated that with Assault One by treating the tire as preeminent to a blowout or a flat. There's 17 different fibers, and at the moment of a puncture, all those fibers come together and immediately and permanently seal the tire from loss of air pressure.
I'm going to show you a maneuver that's, I think, is the best maneuver I've ever seen for a horse. I'm sure I've done it in the past, but I didn't realize that I didn't do it enough, okay? I watched Boyd Rice's tape, and I call it indirect turning, but I don't know what you call it, but for me, Boyd's one of the greatest horsemen ever, and he does a lot of this, and it just softens a horse up. It softens a horse up for anything you want to do. I don't care what, any kind of discipline you got, it'll soften him up. What I do, I get him just walking around my leg, and I'm kind of setting him up for something. For it. I get his nose coming to his chest a little bit. Then when I feel him comfortable, I start backing, indirect backing him. I make him go around like he's almost going around a tree or something. I want him to back. And when I feel that front leg, which would be his right front leg, coming up under him, then I'll lead him out of it. And you see how he just stepped over himself so soft, so smooth. He never got worried about it. I don't try to do a bunch of things at one time and confuse him. I do the one side, then I do the other side. Same pattern. Walk him around your leg. Walk him around your leg. Get his nose coming to you. Get his nose coming to you. Get his nose coming to you. And when I feel him soften up, I'll indirect him back. Indirect him back, indirect him back. When his left front leg starts coming up under him, then I'll lead him out. So they get where they get really, really light when you get ready to turn them. And it does another thing, it keeps their head lower for some reason. I don't know. They don't worry about it.
This week's tip has been brought to you by Assault One Tire Protection. For information on how Assault One can prevent blowouts in your tires, go to their website, assaultone.org. Thanks for joining us for this week's Horse Country USA.
Next week, we're going to take you to Fort Worth, Texas, the home of the Carity Foundation Celebrity Cutting.
And for more information on any of the stories you've seen and for some incredible steals and deals, go to horsecountryusa.net.
I do that. I'll mess you up.
Yeah, I know.
You'll have to go back to school after you're done.